I'm Mick Taylor. I was born on the 17th of January, 1949, in what was a little country town at the time, about 20 miles north of London, called Hatfield. I know my parents loved music because they used to, I think when they were dating, they used to buy each other records. So I think that, you know, they liked Frank Sinatra and Bing Crosby and Glenn Miller and stuff like that. In fact, my parents were wonderful. They really encouraged me to play music, and they actually took me to a concert when I was 9 years old. I went to my first rock and roll concert in 1957, and I went to see Bill Haley and the Comets. I started playing guitar when I was about 10 years old. My mother's younger brother played guitar, and he played the music of that time, which was sort of skiffle rock and roll. I mean, the music that was popular when I was a young child in growing up in the 1950s was it was all American music. It was Jerry Lee Lewis, Elvis Presley, and of course. That music really comes from black American, you know, blues. I wasn't, you know, one is not aware of those things when you're a child, but there was something about that music, there was something about the energy and the joy and the freedom that it expressed that touched me. In fact, the first instrument I ever played was the piano. My mother had a piano, and I used to sit there and play Three Blind Mice and anything, any other little nursery rhyme I could pick out with one hand. And I suppose I must have had a little bit of musical ability. Struggle and hardship and suffering. I mean, it comes from that, you know, if you're talking about blues in a historical sense and about slavery and everything else. But in fact, for the early people that were playing blues, it was like a form of entertainment, a form of escapism, a form of release. It was a way of enjoying themselves. And there was just something about, I mean, the sound of the Chicago blues harmonica and the sound of the guitar and the way the guitar players that I heard, like Buddy Guy and B.B. King especially, the way they made the guitar sing, it was like it had a kind of vocal quality to it that was very, very exciting, very sexual, very, very sensual. Sensual is the word. Few clubs in London in the early 60s where you could actually hear that kind of music. There was, the old Marquee Club was one, and there was a club called The Scene, there was a club called The Flamingo Club, was the one I remember most of all, because I used to go there on Friday night, stay up all night, and go home on Saturday morning. And that's where I heard, all this wonderful music, blues music. Not just blues, though. Soul music, Otis Redding, James Brown, that kind of stuff. When I became aware of the fact that there were English groups playing this kind of music, I wanted to see them and hear them. So I used to go and see John Mayall play a lot, even before Eric Clapton was playing with him. But when Eric Clapton played with him, Eric Clapton was really the first English guy I had ever heard that captured that raw sort of authentic sound that American blues guitarists had. So I was fascinated by that. I was lucky enough, I suppose, to go to a concert that John Mayall was doing at a college near Hatfield, where I grew up in Hertfordshire, and Eric Clapton didn't show up for the gig, so during the interval, because they did two sets, and during the interval, I went backstage and said to John Mayall, "Do you mind if I?" I've heard your albums and I know some of these songs. Could I play with you? Because Eric Clapton's guitar was there, but for some mysterious reason he hadn't shown up. And John Mayall sort of looked at me in a funny kind of way, and I thought for a moment he was going to say no, but much to my amazement he said, "Well, yeah, sure." think you can do it. I was thinking to myself, well, I wasn't thinking, oh, this is a great opportunity for me or anything like that. I just really wanted to get up on stage and play the guitar. And so I did the whole of the second set with them, and we exchanged telephone numbers. And a few years later, he, when he needed a guitar player to replace Peter Green, he asked me to join him. And, and by then I was about 17 years old. And the rest, as they say, is history. I got a call from John Mayall saying that he'd heard that the Rolling Stones were looking for a guitar player to replace Brian Jones, because they were not only finishing an album, but they wanted to go on the road again. They hadn't done anything for 2 or 3 years, and they were about to sign a new recording deal with Atlantic Records, and they needed somebody to replace Brian Jones. So I was invited down to Olympic Studios, where they were putting the finishing touches to Let It Bleed, and ended up playing on Honky Tonk Women. I was 21. The other guys in the band were maybe 5 years, 6 years older. And even though, I suppose, even though they'd had a lot of success, they'd had a lot of hit records, they never really had the reputation of being a great live band. They'd never done any big major tours where they'd been able to play for more than about 20 or 25 minutes. So when I joined them, it became a different type of band. In 1969, that was the beginning, really, of when lots of groups started to tour the world and play in big arenas, big sports stadiums with big sound systems, where you could actually hear what they were playing. And so, you know, it did become a much better band. They still had this hunger to sort of create good music and make good records. So we used to try and make one record every year, and we pretty much did. I think there was the first one was Let It Bleed, and then there was a live one, Get Your Ya-Ya's Out, and then there was Sticky Fingers, Exile on Main Street, Goat's Head Soup. There's about six or seven, you know, major Stones albums that were done between 69 and 75, 76 while I was with them. A lot of people used to think that when I was with the Rolling Stones especially, I was very shy and quiet and retiring. In fact, I wasn't really like that at all. I was very, very boisterous and very outgoing, and always having arguments with Mick and Keith about the music and all kinds of stuff. But, you know, my role in the Rolling Stones was to play guitar. I mean, anybody that's on the same stage as Mick Jagger is going to look a little bit shy, aren't they, and quiet. I mean, I was never sort of an exhibitionist in that sense. Angel,
angel, when will those clouds all disappear? Angel,
I think after 5.5 years, I really had enough. I can't give you one overriding reason for leaving, except I can't really say it was totally down to being frustrated artistically. I didn't feel that I could grow anymore. Either as a person or as a musician. A lot of people think I'm crazy for leaving. People are constantly saying to me, "Why didn't you just stay where you were? You could have been a millionaire by now. You could have been that." But I never really looked at it that way. Well, you don't when you're young and idealistic. But I still don't look at it that way now either, because, to me they peaked then, and I don't really think that they've done as many good albums or written as many good songs as they did, not only while I was with them, but prior to the period I joined them. I'm Rolling Stones, you know, for me, I have mixed feelings about the Rolling Stones, because on the one hand, you know, I love them, and in another way, I hate them. You know, it's a love-hate relationship with me. Always will be. I mean, to me, being a rock star, being celebrated because you're famous is not enough. I mean, these days there's a whole cult of being a celebrity. You know, you can be a celebrity just because you're in newspapers, but I think people should be celebrated for what they actually achieve in music or art or literature, or I think they should be celebrated for what they do, not for how famous they are.
I got blues in the morning. I got blues on my mind. But if it wasn't for bad luck and trouble, I'd have nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing. I'd have almost nothing on my mind. It's summertime in the city. All the girls look so pretty. I feel so high, I could almost reach the sky. I got nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing. I got almost nothing on my mind. Here we go.
When I was 15, I was a big Bob Dylan fan. I was never really much of a Stones fan. I mean, I liked them, but I wasn't really a... My sister was. You know, all the girls liked the Rolling Stones. But so I played with Bob Dylan maybe for nearly on and off for about 2.5 years. We did so much recording that the first one I did is called Infidels. The second one, which is basically stuff that was left over from Infidels is called Empire Burlesque. And then there's a 3-CD box set that came out about 4 years ago of outtakes, and I play on about 6 tracks on that. I really got on very well with him, very well. In fact, I think I enjoyed working with him probably more than anybody else, any other individual I've ever worked with, really, because he became a good friend. He was always writing songs, and one of his songs that called Blind William McTell, that came out on this bootleg series, I've actually ended up recording for my CD, and I was actually in the studio when he wrote the song, and it was amazing to see how quickly he could write a song. I mean, he's written them, I don't know how many songs he's written actually, but more than anybody else I can think of.
I've seen the arrow on the doorpost, saying this land is condemned. All the way from New Orleans to Jerusalem. I traveled through East Texas where many martyrs fell. I know nobody can sing the blues like Blind Willie McTell.
I've been involved in projects and music that have given pleasure to millions of people. So yeah, you know, I've been blessed by God with the talent, and I've been in the right place at the right time, and I suppose I don't know how much luck comes into it really. But what keeps me going, really, apart from needing to make a living, is I just love playing. I love singing, I love playing, and and the more I do of it, the more I enjoy it, you know. Through me, didn't have a word.
looked so wasted and washed out, like the rain that was falling that day. Before I get lost in the shuffle and sink without a trace, the heart turns to stone and my dreams all fly away.
Somebody in Vienna recently, in Austria, gave me a painting, and it was a sort of painting of a, done in very bright colours, of a road sort of disappearing into the horizon, and the title of it was My Home is the Horizon. And that's kind of what it's like, really, because, you know, your home is the next place you're going to. Yeah, I mean, you know, it sounds corny, but, you know, wherever you sort of lay your hat and or wherever you're sleeping that night is kind of your home. So, yeah, it is kind of like a metaphor for whatever it is you're searching for in your art, in your music.
Thank you.
choke me, baby. Choke me all night long. Well, you know you shook me, little darling. You messed up my happy home.
Comforting to hold a guitar. Even now, you know, as I'm speaking to you, I mean, if I was holding a guitar, it would be, there's something about it that just, it connects me to my soul, in a way, my heart, whatever. It really does, you know, and not everybody that picks up the guitar feels that way. But from the moment I picked up the guitar, I always knew that I would play the guitar. And that feeling got stronger and stronger the older I got, you know. It's really like, I mean, I can't imagine not playing the guitar. It's impossible for me. It would be like losing a limb or losing an arm. I would feel like a cripple if I didn't play the guitar. I know that I'm a good guitar player. I mean, people have said to me that that they were, you know, inspired to learn the guitar from some of my previous work with the Stones, which is, you know, it's like very flattering when people say that. I even though I've been around for a long time, I still feel like there's so much more to learn and so much more to do. I don't think you ever really stop learning and developing and expressing yourself, especially in any artistic endeavors, but especially in music. You know, you just carry on developing what you're good at. You carry on playing and singing, and you hope that, you know, people will like what you do.
Thank you.